Timeless Places is a 13 half-hour travel series with an unsolved mysteries kind of a twist and a focus on archaeological enigma.
Bob and Bee Connolly are a husband and wife production team who travel the world creating videos and CD-ROMs. On many of their journeys, they discovered there was more to the world than what met the eye, especially in its ancient past. Their informed guides would give them information about archaeology and historical events that sometimes conflicted with the textbooks. So the Connollys decided to go on a fact-finding mission of their own, searching through museums and libraries the world over to discover what they could about ancient mysteries. They were directed to answers that lay hidden in the architecture of buildings, in monuments and statues they encountered. They began to keep a diary of these unusual observations. This program shows the highlights of that diary. It links the world's timeless places in a search to unlock the ancient riddles that keep the world spellbound. Their journey took 8 years and spanned the entire globe, from the tiny spot in the middle of the Pacific Ocean, known as Easter Island, across the Atlantic to the pyramids of Egypt. This is their search for ancient wisdom.
The gigantic stone figures known as Moai are the reason we have come to Easter Island, a dot in the Pacific Ocean, some 3,300 kilometers west of Chile. To visit the island, we first flew to Santiago, the capital city of Chile. This part of South America has the characteristics of a European lifestyle that is modern and cosmopolitan. Our first stop was to the National Museum of Natural History, where there is a comprehensive collection of Easter Island's historical treasures. We found intriguing messages on odd wooden tablets, but were disappointed to discover that centuries of translation attempts have failed. Today's islanders are unable to read the hieroglyphics of the Rongo Rongo tablets. Curiously, similar writings have been found only in the ruins of ancient temples in India. Did ancient civilizations from India visit Easter Island long ago? We began our journey of Easter Island at Tarawaka, one of the three non-active volcanoes, rising 600 meters above sea level in the northern corner of the island. From here, we could see why the island was dubbed the navel of the world, allegedly by its founder, Hotu Matua.
The hilly island comprises only 117 square kilometers, with the geographical focal point of a volcano. Just recently, Easter Island's lifestyle was dramatically altered. It's of strategic interest to the American Space Exploration Organization, NASA. Because the island was designated as a rescue center in the case of an emergency with the space shuttles, the United States built the island's runway. Only Land Chile has permission to land on Easter Island. There are two flights a week, and on our flight, most of the people were on their way to Tahiti and points beyond. About 15,000 curious people arrive in plane loads each year. Their lingering question is, just who or what is represented by the island's stone statues?
In April 1722, Admiral Jacob Roggeveen and his Dutch crew became the first Europeans to land here on Easter Island. It got its name because the day they arrived was Easter Sunday. What they found here puzzled them tremendously, and the mysteries of Easter Island have continued to baffle archaeologists, anthropologists, and historians ever since. Many of the Moai are capped with huge red stones called topknots. Their eyes look eerily upwards towards the heavens. Directly in front of the statues are circular clearings that look like they were used for sacred ceremonies. There are modern hotels here, but we enjoyed the hospitality of an elderly islander left with a spare bedroom because his son had moved to the mainland. We rented a jeep so we could navigate the whole island with its limited roads. It's so puzzling that when the island was first discovered, there were three distinct races already here: whites, Amerindians, and Polynesians. How did three different groups find this remote place? Today, the locals continue to arduously engrave the symbolic Rongo Rongo tablets, rituals which have been passed down for generations. We were delighted to find Anakena, a beautiful white sand beach, and the legendary landing place of Hotumatua. Just offshore sit some of the best preserved and most photographed of the groups of Moai. The altar is called Ahu Naunau. It's quite extensive, with a row of Moai which also have untranslatable markings engraved on their backs. In the language of the Easter Islanders, the name of these Moai means eyes that look up to the sky. In 1979, when they were restored and excavated, it was believed that the eyes were once inlaid with coral and rock, and that the Moai were once painted.
Silhouettes of the Moai dot the island's circumference, but they all came from this quarry at Rano Reraku. The crater is still littered with toppled Moai, as well as statues in every stage of completion. The largest heads of the Moai appear above ground level, and the rest of the bodies lie buried 20 feet beneath the surface. The islanders believe that each one has a name and an individual spirit. It looks to me as if the rocks from the quarry have been melted. Here, a statue rests abandoned on its back, waiting to be excavated. Also left abandoned are the stones used for the topknots, lying finished at another quarry.
Because only 60 of the Moai are covered with redstone topknots, it's generally considered that the custom of having them was a later development. Each one has the weight of about 2 elephants, and they were rolled from their original location, which is here at the Punapau Quarry. Little pieces of the puzzle are scattered all over the island, and we set off to look at some ruins that might help explain things. At Vinapu, there is a wall adjacent to some overturned Moai. Some believe it is the most significant clue in the puzzle of the island's origins, since the construction is so perfect, built precisely to withstand earthquakes and to stand the test of time. There are a number of different theories about the origins and the builders of the walls here at Vinapu. But the style of these walls is very reminiscent of the ones found in Peru's Cusco Valley. We've heard that more unusual things can be found in Peru than anywhere else. We had misgivings about traveling here because of prevailing horror stories of a cholera epidemic and hostile guerrilla activity. The capital city of Lima today is a major center with contrasting images. Modern skyscrapers mingle with colonial residences and houses made of mud.
The influence of the nation's pre-Hispanic history is evident in the names of signs on the storefronts. We enjoyed leaving the city for the freshness of the air of the Andes Mountains. We left to look for those strange walls like the ones on Easter Island. History claims they were built by the Inca, and that the best examples are in the city of Cusco.
As we flew high into the mountains from Lima to Cusco, we had to wonder why the Inca would build their capital city at such an extreme altitude. Direct 45-minute flights from Lima, which is 1,100 kilometers away, go 2 or 3 times per day. based in Cusco. The Inca Empire started with the Coricanca, a temple which was converted into a church. Since those times, the city has expanded around the temple. So much has survived of the Inca stone constructions that you can still walk along the narrow streets and actually feel the presence of the ancient rulers. Some of the newer buildings have been affected by earthquakes over the years, but the Inca stone constructions have remained virtually unscathed.
To us, the most amazing thing about the city are the huge walls whose stones fit perfectly into the stones next to them. It would be impossible to slide a piece of paper or a razor blade between them. Such incredible masonry skills are not easily accomplished now, never mind thousands of years ago. On the rim of the Cusco Valley, just above the city, lies a fortress called Sacsayhuaman, whose 30-foot cyclopean walls were once three times as high as they are now.
It's amazing to think of Inca architecture when you think about the size of some of these boulders. The original city was actually a miniature Cusco, and it was right behind these walls here. They fit perfectly together as if they were molded like clay. Some blocks weigh 300 tons. Just how did the ancient Inca create such a feat? They had no hard metals to shape the stone. When the Spaniards arrived, they could find no proof that the Inca had actually constructed the walls and attributed their work to the devil. Although much larger, these walls are just like the walls in Easter Island, but our mystery's not solved since nobody can adequately explain the construction of these ones either. The Inca enigma of Machu Picchu is located nearby. Although the train ride to the site is half the adventure, many prefer to walk between the cities. The Inca Trail is quite popular, and aficionados feel they've time-traveled hundreds of years back while hiking this ancient path. The ruins of Machu Picchu are a striking and puzzling panorama, but in Peru, the mystery does not end here. Continuing southward along the desert coastline is another ancient Peruvian riddle. The one in Nasca, involving giant lines and curious drawings over vast stretches of land. The Pan American Highway runs right over the lines, which can't be seen from the ground. The scenery can be monotonous with endless stretches of desert landscape on the horizon. For kilometer after kilometer, there isn't a hint of vegetation until the sand suddenly gives way to an oasis with its trees, water, and well-groomed hotels. It's surprising to find so much life and luxury in the middle of the desert. Although we drove to Nasca, many prefer to fly there since the airport is so convenient. Nasca is most famous for the lines, which are an amazing series of gigantic rock etchings which can really best be appreciated from the sky. You know, since 1901, scientists have wondered, why are they here? And why are they so big? Well, there's an airport right beside Nasca, so you can take a flight and come up with a theory of your own.
Flights are usually taken in the morning, when the winds are best for light aircraft. The doors and passenger seats were removed for us to get a better picture. Sitting on the floor, with one foot on the wing and the other on the wheel, with B in the back taking still pictures, our tour of the lines began. Here, a trapezoid is seen clearly. Anthropologists believe the drawings were made at least 2,000 years ago. Satellite photos show that many of the lines point in the direction of sacred sites, such as Machu Picchu and Sacsayhuaman.
These geoglyphs do not necessarily imply the use of large numbers of laborers or sophisticated instruments, but they do call for the knowledge of basic principles of geometry, planning, and topography. The nagging question is, why were they drawn thousands of years ago to be seen from the air if there was no air travel then? One writer believes that the Nazca people constructed hot air balloons and did, in fact, see the geoglyphs from the skies.
Along with the lines are drawings. One figure, known as the Owl Man, looks otherworldly to us. We're now flying over the area where we can clearly see the drawing of a spider. Crafted with such perfect proportions, it must have been drawn with the use of some precise unit of measurement.
Other drawings include the condor and a hummingbird, all of which are gigantic when measured on the ground. What would have possessed a society at any time in history to carry these drawings through a 400 square kilometer area, as well as all up and down the coast of South America?
If you can't make the flight, there is another way to view the lines. Just alongside the highway, outside of Nasca, there's a tower where you can go up and get a pretty good view of a couple of the drawings.
Standing on the ground, the figures can't really be seen at all. There is a theory that the lines served an astronomical purpose, and that they are aligned with the stars. Or are they pointing to sacred sites in some far-off lands?
After viewing a television documentary which presented the unusual phenomenon of giant granite spheres located in Costa Rica, we decided to travel there northward from Peru. This Central American country might contain clues to Peru's unusual archaeology. Our flight landed in the city of San Jose, a bustling business center defined by decorative turn-of-the-century architecture and a cosmopolitan lifestyle. Costa Rica is a tropical country famous for its healthy, unspoiled environment. Things that makes a tour of Costa Rica so unique is that you can tour active volcanoes. There are seven of them in the country, including this one at Poás.
Like us, people are drawn to the vast areas of healthy jungle. The terrain is rugged and often virtually unexplored, making it ideal for the adventure traveler. The Monte Verde Cloud Forest Preserve was designed for hikers to really enjoy nature at its best. At the entrance, we got a map and booked ourselves for a hike.
The Quakers of the United States and other countries founded the colony at Monte Verde and partially donated the huge biological reserve that's here. There are so many different plants and animals and birds that can be seen, depending on the time of year that you're here. But it's always advisable to come well prepared for the elements when you're trekking through a tropical forest such as this one.
Monte Verde is well marked with signs showing the direction of history walks, nature trails, and the hummingbird gallery. Since Costa Rica supports over 850 species of birds, there's a good chance that some of them will be on hand to charm themselves a bit of breakfast. But then, who could turn one of them down?
For us, the fascination with Costa Rica is the enigma of the huge granite spheres. We heard that a lot of them had been stolen, and we tracked down one that was built right into the lobby of a factory. Although most of the spheres were found and excavated in the southwestern part of the country, many of them had been collected up and are now on display on the grounds of the National Museum.
The National Museum has rooms devoted to pre-Columbian artifacts and displays of Costa Rican life throughout its history. It's a good place to come for a general introduction to the country.
By some of the artifacts, we could see that the early Costa Ricans were skilled in the art of intricately carving stone. We were informed that we could find some of the granite spheres near the town of Palmar Norte on a little island called Isla del Caño. Traveling this area is for the more adventure-minded tourist. On our way, we passed through the somewhat remote town of Sierpe on the Sierpe River. The few buildings here provide supplies for the villagers who live along the coast. From Sierpe, we boarded a water taxi and cruised the river. Other tourists were taking it easy on a cruise ship that anchors nearby. The boat took us to Drake Bay, an area which offers a more primitive lifestyle, often providing only solar power. Spring-fed jungle rivers attract canoe enthusiasts like myself, intent on adventure in the midst of Garden of Eden surroundings.
Once on Caño Island, we hiked in search of artifacts that were rumored to be in the area, which was once an Indian burial ground. Very small spheres and other things have been unearthed. We were disappointed in what the island yielded to us in terms of ancient mystery. It all seems interesting enough, but where were the giant spheres?
We went back along the Sierpe River, enjoying the scenery and the mangroves we sped through. Although adventure travel is on the rise, it's still possible to have rivers like this one pretty much to yourselves. At the general store, a local taxi driver suggested to us that we should try looking for our spheres near the town of Palmar Norte. Sure enough, along with typical small-town scenes such as the ball practice of a local team, we saw spheres lying around as ornaments or monuments. To find the original location of the spheres, we followed the taxi driver's directions to an area next to the town's small airport.
At last, here they were, hidden in the banana fields, in the tiny rural Costa Rican town of Palmar Sur. It is said that all of the country's ancient stone spheres came from these fields. Thousands of years ago, when they were made, they sat on top of the ground, but have now fallen prey to wind and soil erosion. They range in size from 6 inches to 8 feet in diameter and could number in the thousands. Scientists have pointed out that the spheres are arranged in a way to suggest that they were once in a planetary formation, with some representing stars, suns, moons, and planets, like an open-air planetarium. Some of them weigh as much as 16 tons, and to this day, no one knows how these enormous spheres could have been made.
Just what instruments could have been used so long ago to precisely carve these round balls from such hard rock? Because there were no metal tools long ago, one theory is that they were made in molds. To add to the intrigue, precious golden figures were found nearby. In the year 1502, Christopher Columbus became the first European to discover Costa Rica. Indians from the local Carib tribe spoke to him of vast amounts of gold in the area, and thus the country was named Rich Coast, which means Costa Rica. Many of those artifacts can be found here at the Gold Museum in San Jose. We wonder if these pictures of birdmen carrying spheres and golden saucers could be clues to Costa Rica's archaeological mystery. As our plane descends through a haze of smog into Mexico City, our minds are full of images of pyramids, Atlantean figures, and Mayan Indians. Like Peru, Mexico is a predominantly Spanish-flavored country whose early history is swathed in mystery. Vast riches were plundered mercilessly by Europeans, yet fascinating ruins still speak of a much earlier time. For the tourists who worship Mexico's guaranteed sunshine at beaches like the one here at Cancun, history tours are generally not a priority. Luckily for them, There are archaeological ruins from the Maya culture lying right on the beach, wedged between luxury hotels. The influence of the cultures which built Mexico's pyramids are found everywhere. Spanish colonial is another predominant style, recalling the era of Spanish conquest over the Indians. Mexico's cities are lively and congested, featuring architecture that spans all these ages.
Although the Spanish conquest of the 1500s attempted to eradicate Mexico's native culture, it continues to thrive. Various festivals and much of the handicrafts celebrate the trademarks of Mayan and Aztec ancestry. Craftspeople commemorate their ancient gods in tapestries and with wooden carvings. As we ventured into the countryside, we got the feeling that the lifestyle of many Indians today must be a lot like their Mayan ancestors of centuries ago. The people are friendly and happy to pose for pictures.
The Mayans have a tremendous reverence for their ancestors. Here's one hand painting a tombstone. The cathedral in Mexico City stands on the former site of a grand Aztec temple. Although Catholicism reigns in Mexico, it seems that certain traditions die hard. The annual ritual called the Festival of the Dead helps perpetuate the tradition of the native Indians who were the country's ancient pyramid builders. Our Mexican journey takes us on a tour of the pyramids located near Mexico City, in Palenque, and in the Mayan site of Chichen Itza on the Yucatan Peninsula. Tula, near Mexico City, is famous for its Atlantean men, statues found on the archaeological site. At souvenir markets, the most popular replica is that of the Atlantean character. According to local guides, their ancestors came from the legendary lost continent of Atlantis. The original statues are perched atop the Temple of the Morning Star. The archaeological site of Tula is a complex of ruins that date back to between the 9th and the 12th centuries. It consists of small pyramids, columns, and huge stone figures with inscriptions that shed some light on Toltec history.
The locals believe that the mysterious tools held by the statues were used for the construction of the gigantic stone buildings and statues for which there is no logical explanation. The statues appear to be carrying tools or even laser weapons. The features of the Mexican ancestral leaders are quite unusual. The appearance of this Olmec head suggests the presence of an African culture in Mexico's ancient history. Another odd-looking character with an elongated head captured our attention. This legendary ruler is Lord Chilpacal, whose domain centered on Palenque.
In this part of Mexico, the moisture and humidity has resulted in a steamy jungle-like terrain. So much so that when the Spaniards first came through the area, they missed finding the site altogether. The site of Palenque is continually being excavated, but enough has been uncovered at this point to create a good chronology of its history with an emphasis on the reign of Lord Chilpacal. The Temple of the Inscriptions holds Pacal's tomb. I found the climb down into the tomb to be treacherous because the high humidity after the day's rain made the surface of the stone stairs slippery. It was completely blocked off for over 1,000 years. Now the entrance to the tomb is open, but protected by a gate which leads to the crypt.
The sarcophagus is topped with a carved stone slab weighing some 5 tons. The image of Pacal is engraved on the slab, surrounded by images which are meant to relate stories of death and its passage. But others believe that the drawing depicts Pakel surrounded by instruments of some sort of flying machine.
Pyramids of all shapes and sizes can be found in Mexico, including the site of Teotihuacan. According to local myth, it was constructed by giants or gods. The site of Uxmal features an unusually shaped pyramid. We were awestruck by the geometric design of the main building, the Temple of the Magician. The western staircase is incredibly steep at a 60-degree angle, and thankfully, a chain now guides climbers along. It really makes you wonder about the size of the people who were meant to climb these buildings. Today, the Mayan route is a term which refers to the tour one takes when exploring the history of the Mayan civilization in Mexico, mainly on the Yucatan Peninsula. Our final stop was Chichen Itza, which was inhabited from the year 550 BC and reflects both the Mayan and the Toltec time periods. El Castillo, a nine-tiered pyramid, was built according to astronomical calculations with 365 stairs to the top. Chichen Itza is a mixture of the cultures of the Mayans and the later arriving Toltecs. It was likely abandoned near the end of the 13th century, and archaeologists continue to undertake reconstruction of this intriguing sacred site. Curious flat platforms are scattered around the area. This one is aligned to the planet Venus. After touring Mayan sites, we wonder if there's some link between them and the pyramid builders of ancient Egypt. Obelisks and pyramids share the honor of being mysterious and of having certain elements of their unique construction in common. Many obelisks were removed from Egypt and transported to other parts of the world. We begin our journey to Egypt in Cairo, a city with a 70-century-long history. Cairo is remarkably safe, especially for a city so large. Although ancient and steeped in early Egyptian symbolism, it's a very cosmopolitan and forward-thinking center, with modern amenities existing alongside age-old traditions. Shopping is a treat here, with markets and bazaars offering everything from copper pots and leather items to exquisite perfume essences and gold jewelry. One of the most popular purchases is an Egyptian trademark, papyrus art depicting well-known historical themes and archaeological motifs. Many priceless artifacts were taken from Egypt to far-off lands, but a wealth of them still remain to be seen at the Cairo Museum. The most well-visited part of this museum is the tomb of King Tutankhamun. It was found intact in the year 1922.
This figure of King Tut was found in his burial chamber in the Valley of the Kings. His pyramid-shaped apron signifies that he was one of Egypt's master builders. King Tut married into the unusual family of King Akhenaten. These artifacts depict Akhenaten's daughters, whose elongated head proportions have been the source of great intrigue and debate among scholars. Then, of course, there are the pyramids themselves.
The pyramids of Giza have inspired countless theories regarding their dimensions and about their construction in general. Located on an area of 2,000 square meters, they are one of the seven wonders of the world. The inside of the Great Pyramid of Cheops is a subject of tremendous controversy concerning the pyramid's age and purpose. The various corridors link the king's and queen's chambers, and many claim to feel a surge of energy after walking through. Egypt's pyramids are numerous and have captured the imaginations of people the world over. Saqqara is a royal necropolis. It's the funerary complex of Zoser, the third dynasty. It's been said that the necropolis surrounds the royal tombs in a kind of a mock palace so that the king's spirit could pursue his life in the other world.
This step pyramid is the oldest in Egypt. The nearby necropolis lies buried in the desert sand. There is history carved into the very walls of these granite subterranean tombs. Early Egyptians are renowned for commemorating all aspects of their lives by engraving hieroglyphics. The stone used to build these walls had to be transported from quarries located hundreds of kilometers away. Egypt's granite monuments all came from the quarries in the Aswan area. Like the majority of tourists on history tours of Egypt, we have decided to travel between Luxor and Aswan by riverboat.
The Nile River is the lifeblood of the Egyptian people, and it's been revered since the beginning of time. Most visits to Egypt will include a cruise down the Nile between the cities of Luxor and Aswan, and it really is the very best way to get around to the different temples and villages.
Our boat docked at each of the temples along the route. It's a convenient arrangement, although sometimes we had to pass across several boats to get to shore. So many of them can be rafted together at the same time. A horse and buggy is a good way to get to the temples from the boat.
The town of Luxor is the main tourist center for the largest surviving concentration of ancient monuments in the Nile Valley. It was once called Thebes, which is a name that now refers to the whole area.
Here at Karnak, there are enormous monuments made of single pieces of solid granite, known as obelisks. They are some of the greatest achievements left behind by Egypt's master masons and stonecutters.
The Temple of Edfu was completed during the Ptolemaic Age on the site of an older sanctuary. It's the second largest temple after Karnak.
Magnificent columns of sandstone support a temple that is said to have been designed incorporating the principles of sacred geometry. As we continued back aboard our riverboat, we could see just how fertile the area was next to the Nile. The river has also been a handicap because of the flooding, which is now controlled by the Aswan Dam. The Temple of Philae was relocated to avoid the Nile's waters. Similarly, the statues at Abu Simbel, around 240 kilometers south of Aswan in the Nubian Desert, had to be moved here. In the 1960s, they were taken from their original location to higher and safer ground at a cost of around $9 million.
Two kilometers from Aswan are the old quarries where all the granite came from to build the country's temples, monuments, and pyramids. There is an obelisk here that was never completely excavated. A dog seemed to point us in the direction of a large hole, which made us wonder what type of tool was used to drill 6 feet deep into one of the hardest stones on Earth.
The unfinished obelisk is 137 feet long and weighs 1,168 tons. It was abandoned because of a fissure in the stone, but it serves as a way of illustrating how massive stones were quarried.
Archaeologists and stonemasons are baffled by the lost technology the Egyptians used to cut and transport solid granite, a task which is almost impossible to duplicate today. Historians claim that incredible architectural feats were accomplished by the pharaohs, who were able to construct amazing structures such as the pyramids. Perhaps we could unlock some of the mystery by studying Moses, another Egyptian builder who was the keeper of the secrets of the Ark of the Covenant.
As aficionados of movies like Raiders of the Lost Ark, we're excited to continue our search to retrace the exodus of Moses and the Israelites from Egypt into Israel. People have come to live in Israel from every corner of the earth. Young travelers find safe and affordable accommodation in hostels, on kibbutzes, or in campgrounds. Many come to join in a dig for archaeological treasures, an activity which is always going on. You can purchase the less valuable artifacts, while the rarer ones find a place in museums. The Israel Museum houses cultural exhibits from all over the country. The most important exhibit is that of the Dead Sea Scrolls, and they're housed here at the Shrine of the Book. In this underground fortress are rare 2,000-year-old scrolls that contain the ancient writing of scribes. Their scrolls, some of which comprise today's Bible, were discovered near the Dead Sea in water jars. In the recent past, interpreting them has been the source of controversy amongst scholars worldwide. Not ones to resist a mystery where we can find it, we decided to track through the desert to the area where the scrolls were found. At the same time, we thought we could get a feel for the land which was the setting for all the stories in the Bible.
We retraced the journey of Moses when he left Egypt. The Ark of the Covenant was built in the desert and taken to Jerusalem. A tent called the Tabernacle was built to house the Ark, a powerful device used to protect the Israelites. The Tabernacle was a portable temple overlaid in gold, and the Ark was kept inside a room called the Holiest of Holies.
Copies of these stories from the Bible were written by scribes who rolled them up and placed them in urns. They were found by accident in the 1950s, near the Dead Sea, here at the Qumran Caves. The Dead Sea is at the lowest point in the Jordan Valley. In fact, at 1,320 feet below sea level, it's the lowest point in the world. The waters are known for their curative powers. They contain anywhere from 27 to 35% salt and 2.5 pounds of minerals for every liter of water. The hotels and health spas by the Dead Sea can be quite luxurious. It's great fun to float in the sea's incredibly salty waters, all within a short drive of Jerusalem. Jerusalem is around 5,000 years old and has a population of about 500,000 people. It's one of the oldest continuously inhabited cities, and it's considered a holy place by a third of the world's population.
At the center of constant intrigue is an area where the remains of King Solomon's temple sits. It's still possible to see how grand and ambitious the construction of this temple was. Inside the Dome of the Rock, the Ark of the Covenant once sat. Outside the temple, at the Wailing Wall, people pray daily. Many of them pray that King Solomon's temple will one day be rebuilt to its former glory. What now lies crumbled and in ruins was once the most majestic and powerful place in the world.
This pyramid-shaped tomb beside the temple marks the resting place of the prophet Zechariah. His words about the temple's construction are written in the pages of the Bible, ancient wisdom that helped shape the foundation of modern civilization. How much of the world's early history is linked? Does Easter Island's archaeology have some connection with the Cyclopean walls found in Peru? If the Nasca lines were some giant map pointing to lost cities, can they be related to the astronomical configuration of the unexplainable granite spheres in Costa Rica? Are the pyramid builders of Mexico and their leaders in some way related to the pharaohs of ancient Egypt who built the astronomically and mathematically perfect pyramids and obelisks? Was their knowledge passed down to biblical figures such as Moses, who understood the powers of the Ark of the Covenant and whose story is recounted in the Bible? The search for ancient wisdom is only the beginning of a journey of discovery, a journey to the world's timeless places.